Welcome back to the channel, everybody. Today I am joined with a very special guest. Just kidding, my brother won't be in camera, but he did hear that I'm going to be making dinner, which is not a usual occurrence for me. So obviously tonight's vlog is an evening vlog, which is something I haven't done in the house yet, since apparently I am so domestic, I'm going to cook and I'm not that domestic, so I will be using HelloFresh. But HelloFresh is the best way to learn new recipes, save money, save time at the grocery store. You can have it for two people, you can have it for four people, you can cater to all your dietary different needs and wants. It shows up right to your doorstep. It's my absolute favorite in the entire world. And I wanted to kick off the new year, obviously, by doing a HelloFresh box. And the reason why we're kicking off the video by doing it is because Hudson is apparently hungry. So, yeah. Yeah, I'm talking about you. That's what happens when you don't want to be in the video. I get to talk about you on camera. I'm letting Hudson pick because he has the option of one of my famous recipes from HelloFresh. My sweet chili pork bowl, my amazing Parmesan crusted chicken, or my classic, alluring classic beef and cheese tostada.
Ooh.
I know, what can I say?
Why can't we make all?
We can't make all three because we have to have them for three different nights of the week for dinner.
I think this is gonna be a good challenge for you.
You think this is gonna be a challenge for me?
This one's in your wheelhouse.
I can do a little sweet chili pork bowl. See, what Hudson doesn't know is with HelloFresh, all the ingredients are pre-measured and it gives you step-by-step instructions, so it's really foolproof, even for me.
We'll see.
Wow. Funny thing about me is I don't know how to use my own stove. Wrong one. A wise man once said, easy peasy, nuggy. What are you doing? Hudson. So while I have you here, I'm gonna talk to you guys about my workout routine that I've been doing since I got to the house. Basically, I start off every day with about a 4 mile run, and I started doing it in this like new part of the neighborhood. It's really, really pretty. Abs twice a day, every day. It's a challenge on TikTok.
Act natural.
Not gonna lie, that was really easy. And it made me like cooking again. New kitchen, new year, new me. Oh my God.
It's really good.
Right?
What's the glaze?
You mean the glaze that I made?
Tell us the secret sauce.
The secret sauce. I guess I'll let you know. So we're gonna eat really quick because Hudson's now eating out of the pan because he loves it so much. I'm such a good cook. Go to HelloFresh.com and use my code 10LaurenElizabeth to get 10 free meals, including free shipping. And since my brother won't be on camera, but he is now ruining the whole dish and I would like to plate it for him, we'll be right back. I almost just had like a flashback and I thought I was in my old room for a second when I like looked at the viewfinder. Whoa. Just finished dinner and cleaning up. And I was thinking of figuring out what I want my room to look like since all I have is a mattress on the floor right now. And I realized, I still haven't told you guys the story of like how this whole house came to be. So let's sit down, turned on the fake fireplace, set the mood, showered today, so go off, queen. Okay, so basically, obviously the move happened really, really fast, but I had been thinking about buying a house for the past year. So obviously rushing into like buying a home, especially your first home or just any home, is not something you should rush into, but it really wasn't something that I had just started thinking about. I had been thinking about it seriously at the start of like the beginning of 2020. It was like this weird time in my life where I was just like, I'm not like old enough to get married, but I'm not young enough to think it's like that far off, so I should probably know like what's going on with my life before I just like buy a house, because that'd be weird if like I do want to like spend the rest of my life with someone and then just like bought a house. And it's not the worst thing because obviously I'm still hoping I find someone that I want to spend the rest of my life with, but it's also like if I was going to be moving in with a significant other, I didn't think I needed to buy a house like right then and there. And then on the financial side of it, I was just like, I clearly am staying in LA. I've been here for like 6 or 7 years and I've been renting for a really long time. Put put that into a mortgage instead of rent, then I own it. So like financially, it's a smart thing to do. Let me figure out my life. So my life decided to explode on its face, obviously. Well, I don't know where I'm gonna live when my lease is up. I feel like I need to start looking for a house because clearly I'm gonna be single and I don't just wanna like rent for another 12 months because that could be money that's going towards a house. Therefore, I started looking for a house. After one of my many mental breakdowns, I was sitting on my friend Michelle's couch and we found the house that I'm currently living in that I purchased. I feel like I'd seen it before when I was looking like months ago, but for some reason it just like hit different. I was like, wait, it is so gorgeous. It's so perfect. Like this looks really great. And so I came to see the house and I fell in love with it. I was like, this is so cool. But like buying a house is obviously terrifying and I was still struggling from the breakup. So like I wasn't obviously my best self. I wasn't like productive, proactive. I'm really good in survival mode. Like I can really get it done and I can really put one foot in front of the other. Just, I feel like that's how I have been my whole life, but it was still like a weirder situation. So it took me like, let's say a week to even put an offer in on the house. It took me 7 days too long because by that point, two other people on the same exact day that I finally put my offer in, put an offer in on the house. And I was literally, I kid you not, devastated. Cause keep in mind, like I just got my heart broken, which is like a very big form of just rejection. I just like got like this opportunity rejected from me because it felt like, you know, I wanted it. I was ready to put my offer in. I was ready to do it. Yet someone like beat me to the punch. It just felt like a different form of rejection, even though like obviously it's not the same thing at all. In that like emotionally fragile state, it's just kind of like, oh my God, do I not know anything? I can't do anything right. Like I just keep failing after failing. With everything I've been taught through like my sobriety and everything over the past year is like, you have to like turn your will and your life over to God or your higher power or the universe. And so I really had to begin practicing that even more than I already did at the beginning of my sobriety in my heartbreak. And so I literally just remember being like, I know it's a huge decision and it really isn't in my control at all anymore. All I could do was try. That's why I was like, you know what? I'm gonna put an offer in because I can't know if I don't try, right? That's how I feel about a lot of stuff in life is like, you don't know until you try. Like you miss 100% of the shots you don't take. And it's easier to kind of take those shots when you're like sober and confident and like thinking clearly. So since I like no longer had control in the situation, I'd already put the offer in. They did accept my offer as like a backup offer. If the other escrow falls through, like if something goes wrong, I would be the first like runner up. Like they had to go to me. They couldn't take someone else first. Since I did that, I just said, you know what? It's meant to be, it would have been, but I can at least do the backup offer. Like why not? Like these things happen sometimes. It's so weird because this house like felt like it was the one so bad. So I was like so confused when I didn't get it, just in a way of like, it felt so right. It was just so weird. And so when I didn't get it, I obviously did the backup offer, but I didn't really think too much of it. Just like, it was more just like, okay, like at least I got like something. That's a win. But I knew I still needed somewhere to live. I spent the next like week going and touring homes, staying really, really positive, even though I was obviously like a miserable human being at the time, just because of like my personal life imploding and just like not knowing where I was gonna live. I tried not to be negative. I think looking for a house was a really good distraction, just in terms of like with a different kind of stress. Like I'm not saying it's like that's the distraction when you're going through a heartbreak. It was more like I just had something else to like stress about, I guess. So it technically was a good distraction, even though there's like other better ones. I just really turned it over to the universe. I was like, as long as I keep looking at houses and as long as I keep trying and I keep doing the right things, I'll find something. And so I was going and touring houses, and in California, like you like write a letter to like the sellers. I wrote a letter to the people that were selling this house, just like a little bit blurb about myself and like how much I love the house and how I'd be like so, you know, grateful if they like, you know, accepted my offer. Then I went to another house and it was still like under construction. And the cool thing about if you get a house while it's under construction is you can help them kind of pick out some of the finishes. So you could pick like that stone, you could pick like the wood floor color, like stuff like that. So I thought, oh my gosh, that'd be so exciting. Like I could really make it my own home. And the developer who was doing the house happened to be there. And so he was telling me kind of about his vision and like something like in the energy felt like interesting for a second. And I just remember like thinking like, okay, this like feels like, it was like such a split second because everything happened so quickly, but it was like this split second where I was like, this is interesting. Just what he was describing to me. The seller's agent was like, oh, you saw his other house. And I was like, what? And she was like, yeah, he lives on so-and-so street. Like my jaw dropped to the floor. You would have thought that I just like met Taylor Swift. I was like, oh my gosh, I'm like the backup offer on your other house. It is such an honor to meet you. Like I love your work that you do. Your home is so beautiful. I wrote a letter. Did you read my letter? Like, I put the offer in. I just think I was so excited that, like, God had put this guy in my same path that happened to be like doing one house, even though I'd already been to his other house. Cause like, that's what I mean. Like that split second when he was describing to me this new house he was building, like it had this feeling of familiarity, even though like I didn't know what it was yet. So I all of a sudden got so excited. I was just like, I can't believe like I'm meeting you and you're building this house. Like I knew that there was something with this house that was meant to be, like I knew it felt like home. So we were talking about this project that he was doing, this new house that he was building. And I got in the car with my real estate agent and I was just like, I knew that there was something with that other house. I knew that I loved it so much. I knew it felt like home, that it was somehow meant to be in a certain way. And like, I guess this is the way of like doing another house with him. Like, this is so exciting. It feels like it's meant to be because of this like crazy, this everything happening for this reason. So I decided to start going through the steps to do a new house and build one of the other developers' houses with him. It was like November, I think, and I got a call after like all this time. I hadn't put down money yet or signed anything, because when you're like doing a new build house and you're doing it that way, it is a longer process, which was gonna be complicated, but I was willing to do. And thank God it is complicated, because like a week and a half later, I get a call saying, okay, they approved your offer for like the new construction home, but crazy little thing just happened. The other people that were buying the first house you liked just dropped out, like something happened with their deal, and you're the first backup offer, so it's yours if you want it. So I was just like, I was not expecting that at all. I was like, there's no way that something's gonna go wrong with their escrow. And then all of a sudden I got this call and they were like, no, actually the house is now yours if you want it. And I was just like, what? I was literally like freaking out. I just couldn't believe it was true. And I literally called my grandma and I was just like, remember how we said if the house is meant to be, it will be. It is actually currently being. Should I do it? Because at this point I was like, you know, starting to get myself hyped out about the other one. I talked to my grandma and my mom and I was like, the yard is better. It's the one I initially fell in love with. It was just crazy. And so I like called my agent back right away and I was like, don't lose it again. Like I can't lose it again. I can't lose it again. Like I want the house. Let's do it. Like I'm in, it's mine, I'm here. And we literally started the escrow process that day. I remember I had inspections for the house just like a few days later. I was literally, I think, having a panic attack on the way to inspection, just because of things in my personal life. It was a very brutal few months, so I don't even know how I managed to like make it out of an escrow alive, because it's also super stressful, like getting a house. And I remember talking to the agent and running into like the seller's wife or something. They were just like, yeah, like your energy was so contagious, like you were so positive and you were so kind, and they just knew how much you loved the house and the other deal wasn't working out, like you got so lucky. They knew how much you loved it, they wanted you to have it. Like, obviously I paid for it, but I think it's like when you know something's getting tricky and you know that there's someone else who maybe would be a little easier and loves the house and is like ready to move into it. I think it was kind of beneficial for all the parties involved. It was just crazy the way it happened, because it was the first time ever in my life where I haven't tried to be over controlling, freaking out, super super anxious. Like, yes, I get stressed and I get anxious and all that stuff, but like when I got rejected, I actually accepted it and turned it over. And like, usually I fight tooth and nail, I go running after things, like I chase after people that don't want to be chased, and I chased after things that maybe I don't need to chase after. I finally stopped chasing people and I stopped chasing things. For once in my life, I realized that like, if I actually did that, if it's actually meant to be, like it will come back. This house did that, and I know that it's just a house and it's just a tangible thing, but to learn that lesson on such a massive scale when like, you know, it's a huge financial risk, you know, houses, people get emotionally attached to houses a lot. It was this first moment where I was able to see it come to fruition and really turning over my will and my power over to something greater than myself. And it was crazy. And honestly, like the escrow probably wouldn't even have been as manageable if it weren't for the fact that like I did give off such a good impression. I did handle myself with such grace, positivity, and kindness and patience, because I mean, escrow is insane. It was just the only thing I could do was surrender throughout every single stage of buying a home and during getting broken up with, I guess. I had just surrendered for like 3.5 months. And so that's why I think I was talking on my podcast recently. I've learned that in such a huge, huge way, but it's like now there's all these like daily little things that I have to really remind myself, like remember when you surrendered and you admitted you were powerless and you stopped trying to be powerful over these things and you just let them work out the way they were supposed to. Like, why don't I start doing that throughout my day instead of just when like shit hits the fan? Because shit was hitting the fan in my life and I handled it gracefully the right way and things ended up really working out miraculously. So now it's like, how do I do that in my everyday life in little ways? Because I believe that it's like the little things you do that add up to the great things in your life. All the little things I did to add up to this great thing was getting sober and working on my spirituality and working on my anxiety and working on my depression, all of that stuff. So this was just a huge gift at the end of 2020 for me after everything I've worked on internally to be able to live that way for these really, really horrible few months in my life. It wasn't always easy. It's not like I'm saying going through this process and going through heartbreak was like nice and dandy because of this. It just shows that like when I felt the negative feelings, when I felt the positive feelings, when I like actually looked at them and felt them and dealt with them and decided to heal, I was able to get through them in this type of way as opposed to handling them in a really unhealthy or toxic or kind of not wanting to deal with them type of way. So that's like this really weird little mini story time about how I got this house. Essentially, just the reason why I want to say it is just because it truly felt like this mini miracle in my life. And I prayed so much about it. I surrendered so much about it. A beautiful silver lining to come out of getting my heart broken. Also because I would have never been in this house if it wasn't for getting my heart broken. So as much as that sucks and it still sucks and it hurts, like who knows where I would be in a year? Who knows where I would be living this time, right now, currently in this moment? I don't even want to know what my life would have been. We can always guess about that. We can always do that. But it's like even surrendering in the heartbreak allowed me to kind of go on this journey and mission to figure out my living situation and start my life on my own terms and put my roots down somewhere for me. So as much as I was like hysterically crying every single day and having panic attacks and anxiety and blah, 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 you can still like wipe your tears every once in a while to walk out in public and then come back home and cry. So I think it's like a really cool silver lining of the heartbreak of being able to like wipe my tears for long enough periods of time to feel safe, because I didn't feel safe for a long time and I feel safe now just knowing that like I'm capable of taking care of myself. I have a place I call home. I built it myself. It's just like this like safety net. Like this house is my safety net in a sense of like, it's not like, oh, my lease is up and I don't know where I'm gonna live. Should I move back to Chicago? It's like I just kind of made the executive decision for myself and stopped kind of being wishy-washy and freaking out about my future and just decided to take control of it on my own, even in the darkest time where I probably like didn't need to be doing that. I could have like not done that. I think it ended up being good because I feel like if I didn't do that, if I didn't get this house when I did, probably would have gone home to Chicago over Christmas, probably ended up living in Chicago for a little bit, which wouldn't have been a bad thing. I just think that everything is, you know, happens for a reason. And I think that this happened because it's meant that I am supposed to stay in California. I think I was just so happy and felt so good back in Chicago and so sad at the same time that it was like this weird thing of probably would have ended up staying here if I didn't have a house, because no part of me really wanted to come back here besides to this house. So it'll be an interesting new type of challenge. I'm already dealing with it. Even being back for the past 2 weeks, it's like I had this beautiful silver lining and now I don't really know what I'm doing with my life at all, but it's okay. And I just have to probably listen to this video back as well. My brother wants to play music really bad, so I'm going to stop with the story time for a second and I'll see you guys after we go watch a little bit of TV. I hope you guys enjoyed the little story time dinner vlog. All I do before bed is brush my teeth, need some lip balm, put on a little bit of extra moisturizer, and then sometimes we do a little fire, watch a little extra TV. Who's excited to have nightstands in a bed? So I'll keep you guys updated on my room progress if you want it. Now that you guys know the story of how I got the house, get excited for more house content, more stay-at-home content, because that's all there is to do in California right now. So stay safe, stay sane. If you guys want some mood boosters, make sure to go listen to the podcast and follow me on Instagram for more. I will see you guys in just a few days in the next vlog.